Good evening. Thanks so much for being here tonight. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we're on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to the launch celebration for Reagan Jackson's book, Still Here, presented in partnership with Minerva Labs Publishing. We'd like to thank author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. We're also grateful to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have just a couple quick announcements before we get started. First of all, Reagan's book is available through her website, reaganjackson.com, as well as at indie bookstores near you. So I know that Third Place, Sawyer Park has copies, and I think other bookstores like Elliott Bay or eBookstore will have copies soon if they don't already. But you can also order it directly from reaganjackson.com. So, and it's beautiful. We'll have time for your questions toward the close of the event. And if you think of a question during the course of the event, that's great. You can pop it into the Q&A box that's at the bottom of your screen at any time during the program. And then at the end of the program, we'll get to as many questions as we're able. And finally, after the program, we're interested in hearing from you. We will be posting a link to a survey that will be posted in the chat, and you'll need to copy and paste that link into your browser window in order to fill out the survey, but we'd love to hear what you think, and you can give us feedback about all sorts of things there. So please take a minute after the event to fill that survey out. Now I am delighted to introduce Reagan, who is going to share an excerpt from the book and some insights into its creation before welcoming the rest of tonight's special guests, including Aisha Al-Amin, Danny Terrell, and Michael B. Main. So Reagan Jackson is a multi-genre writer, activist, and international educator with an abiding love of justice, spirituality, and creating community. Reagan's passionate about providing young people with mentorship, leadership skills, and the opportunity to experience something new. And to that end, she is the program director for Young Women Empowered and is also the co-founder of Blackout Healing. Reagan's here tonight to talk about her new book, Still Here, a South End Mixtape from an Unexpected Journalist. Please help me welcome Reagan Jackson. Hi, Reagan.
Hi, Stacia. Thanks for that welcome. And thank you also for doing a land acknowledgement. I think it's really important, especially as we get started, to really acknowledge when and where we enter this conversation. So yeah, well, thank you. Thanks everyone for coming. I'm really excited. This book, as many of you may or may not know, is a long time in the making. And I'm grateful that it is out. It is out there in the world. For those of you who have pre-ordered, I signed the first like 50 copies or so, and they are in the mail as of today. So thank you for that, Michael. So I'm gonna dive right in, and I'm going to read an excerpt from the foreword. And I'm gonna just tell you a bit more about it. The beginning. If I didn't define myself for myself, I would be crunched into other people's fantasies for me and eaten alive. Audre Lorde. I have long felt the crushing weight of the strange paradox of being both invisible and hypervisible as a Black woman in America. The need to process my experiences has kept me coming back to writing. Though I've been a writer for the majority of my life, I didn't really see a place for myself in journalism. In the early 1900s, W.E.B. Du Bois wrote about the theory of double consciousness in his book, The Souls of Black Folks. He posited that being Black and being American is to look at the world with two understandings, that of the white mainstream lens and that of our own cultural perspective. It is this double consciousness that has made me skeptical and critical of journalism for the ways it has been used as a tool of systemic oppression to vilify and misrepresent people of color, but it is also what positioned me well to become a counter-narrative. I was introduced to Sarah Studeville, Jessica Partnow, and Alex Stonehill, the co-founders of the Seattle Globalist, in 2013. We met over brunch at the home of my friend and media justice activist, Sabrina Roach. Sabrina introduced me as a person who liked to write and someone passionate about study abroad. I fell into a rant about the ways in which people of color are excluded from study abroad programs and how the white solution is to mistake color for economic status and throw money at the problem. Yes, money is sometimes one obstacle that people of color face in making the decision to study abroad, but we're always making a way out of no way, finding scholarships, hosting spaghetti dinners, circulating GoFundMe pages. The challenges that go unmentioned are the fact that many of these programs were not designed with us in mind. I told the story of the Black girl who went to South Africa on a study abroad program only to arrive at a white homestay with a family that had a dog that was trained to bite Black people. There is a global misconception, often perpetuated by white media, that the US is a white country. Still, what kind of negligence exists that a university would send a student to such an unsafe environment? What if that student had been white? Would it have been acceptable for them to stay in a home with people who harbored such hatred? What would they have learned about South Africa? I shared my own experience of being Black in Spain on a predominantly white program and the microaggressions I experienced both in the group of my peers and in the host country itself. Alex turned to me and said, "That sounds interesting. You should write about it." I had unwittingly pitched my first story. I went home, wrote a couple of pages, and emailed it to him. To my surprise, he published it with minimal edits and sent me a check. Like millions of people, I had a blog. I was also a contributor to the Black Girl Nerds blog. I had written two articles in high school, one that published in the Madison Times and the other in the Capital Times, but the process never felt so official. After my first article, I followed up with another, and within a few months, they offered me a column. When I told my dad that I was going to be a reporter, the first thing he said was, "Don't be that asshole who sticks the microphone in the face of the person who just lost their kid." His words challenged me to think critically about the role of journalist. We tell the facts, we report what happened, but so much of what has been written about my community has been narrated by people from outside of it, with no context to understand the facts enough to articulate the full truth. I wanted to tell stories from my community, but never at their expense. Through years of conditioning by white media, we have been taught that journalism is sensational, concise, and didactic, and should be narrated without emotion or bias. That is not who I wanted to be or how I wanted to write. I needed to create a new paradigm of ethics. I have biases, lots of them, and opinions and perspectives, and I didn't want to leave them out, but rather use them to reframe the news. I wanted to tell more complete stories, to create a space for nuance and balance, authenticity and perspective. Could I do this? Could I be the journalist that didn't lose myself or my voice? There was no guarantee that this was possible. I had no roadmap, but The Globalist was new too, just barely 6 months off the ground. The PI had closed its doors, and the Seattle Times seemed to be in a decline. The Stranger had gone from indie to establishment. Journalism as we knew it was dying. Standing at the funeral, suddenly there was an opportunity to right some wrongs, to stop begging for representation and trying to get a foothold into the mainstream. I took a chance that together we could do something I hadn't seen done. Alex took a chance on me too, and extending the invitation to write. I had never worked with an editor before, and I was hesitant to invite anyone to critique or censor my writing. One of the perks of invisibility is that you don't have to follow rules. No one was listening to me anyway. I could say or write whatever I wanted, but here was this invitation, this opportunity to be heard. Alex was a patient editor. Sometimes I would pitch an idea and he couldn't see the story, but he was open to letting me try. He asked smart questions that helped me to reframe and clarify my words and sometimes poked holes in my arguments so that I could see where I needed to shore up my research. Despite my misconceptions about journalism being a dry, concise form of writing stripped of all personality, I found myself working with an editor who was interested in my voice and my perspective. He helped me to become visible and to be heard in a way I hadn't before. The Seattle Globalist showed me who I could be as a journalist and what I could contribute to a field poised to acknowledge its own failure to represent communities of color in an equitable and accurate way, and ripe for reinvention. It opened a door for me, a pathway to a platform where not only did I get to say what I wanted to say, but where there were people who wanted to hear it. In 2014, my column took second place at the SPJ's Society of Professional Journalists Excellence in Journalism competition. And the Washington Press Association awarded me first place in the editorial category for Black History Month, the same old song and dance, a piece I wrote about a minstrel performance at Spectrum Dance. It felt like an inside joke to update my bio with the title of award-winning journalist when I still didn't even really think of myself as a journalist. This was all an experiment. How far could I take it? Would there come a day when somebody pointed out I didn't really know what I was doing? I had imposter syndrome, not because I didn't know I was a talented writer or love the work I was doing or think it was important, but because I didn't feel like I had any models for the ways in which I wanted to engage. In July of 2014, I wrote my first viral article. I was on deadline for a story about a Somali woman. She had been kidnapped by her family, who then tried to force her into a marriage when they found out that she was gay. We spent hours together. Her story was the stuff of movies, but in the end, for fear of retribution from the family she had just so narrowly escaped, she begged me not to publish it. This was that moment where if I were Lois Lane, I would have a huge headliner. I sat there staring at my phone, knowing it contained hours of our interview. At this point, I didn't legally need her consent to write the piece, but I decided to respect her request. It was not my story to share. Pissed and disappointed and still on deadline for my column, I drafted up a quick piece I've been kicking around about my neighborhood. Who's Afraid of Rainier Beach was a game changer. I went to bed and woke up the next morning to see 30 comments in the comment section, with more posting every few minutes. And long comments too. Someone had shared it on the Rainier Beach Facebook page, and the thread there was heated and expansive. What struck me most was not the contention, but that people were actually engaging with what I wrote and with one another. They were sharing their Rainier Beach stories. I inadvertently struck a chord in my community. Our editorial meeting that week was a buzz. Until that point, our tagline, "Where Seattle Meets the World," had been a guiding post around content. We mostly talked about international issues, and though the 98118 is lauded as being one of the most diverse zip codes in the country, the piece did not have a strong link to anything global. And yet our readers were saying that this was important and that this was something they wanted to hear about. Writing this piece expanded the scope of our coverage. I knew tons of people in my community through my work as a community organizer, but this was the piece that introduced me to them as a journalist. I started fielding pitches. People came to me with events they wanted me to attend, books they wanted me to read, and stories they wanted to share. Sarah Studeville connected me with Marcus Harrison Green. He came to me for writing lessons, and we became friends. He started his own online news aggregate called the South Seattle Emerald, which seemed like an answer to the outpouring of energy that showed up in response to my Rainier Beach article. People in the South End were sick of being misrepresented in mainstream media. We had something to say, and the Emerald would be our new platform. I started writing for both publications. I also began to work as an editor for the Emerald and discovered I really liked being on the other side of that process. When Marcus started an internship program, I worked with the first cohort on the basics of writing. Through the Globalist, I was invited to teach a writing with voice workshop as a part of the series of pop-up workshops to train folks throughout the city on the basics of journalism and to cultivate new contributors. I loved and still love working with new writers. It felt powerful to open the door for them in the way that Alex had opened the door for me. And that is where I'm gonna stop for now. Hi, friends. Okay, I'm glancing down at the chat. What's going on, Mom? Is everything good? Okay, cool. Yeah, I see I see my mom is here. That's great. Thanks for being here. And thank you, other friends. Appreciating this love in the chat. Don't cry, Alex. Dry your tears. it is lovely. Thank you so much. It is so weird to be doing this on Zoom. I'm low-key pissed off that I'm not in person with you guys. I miss my friends. I miss my community. I miss, you know, seeing people. You don't know how great I smell, and you should. I smell amazing. Just saying. Yeah, but back to this book. So first I do want to give a shout out to Marcus, because Marcus is one of the people who was like, hey, Reagan, you should write a book. Like, actually, you already have written a book. Look at all these articles you've written. And I was like, yeah, whatever. But then I really thought about it. And I was like, no, I've been writing. I've been pretty prolific in my writing. So I do have a stack of articles. And what would it be like if I put them together? So a couple of things I want you to know about this book. One is basically, as soon as you write a book, it's like literally you hit send, it's done, it's all the way together. And then you realize there's like 8 other things that you should have put in this book. So let's just call this volume 1. You know, I'm definitely gonna wanna add to it, because there's some more that I feel like needs to go in this book. So the way that it's structured is this first part, the foreword, is a bit of this memoir piece that goes a bit further into the story of my journey and just what it was like and what are the decisions I made around choosing to be a journalist and around choosing to write in this way. And the rest of it is an anthology of a collection of different articles. And I organized it in a very specific way, because one of the things, you know, going back to this idea of me as a person who, you know, is the unexpected journalist, because my entry point into journalism was so unexpected, I didn't have just one beat. Like, I didn't just get either stuck covering something that other people wanted me to cover. Like, I had the great privilege and the great honor of getting to choose to write about whatever I wanted to write about. And for those of you who know me personally, you know, I have a lot of different interests that don't all go together. And so I was trying to think, what are the through lines in this book? And so I organized it in sections. The first part is called The Hood. So that's me talking about Rainier Beach and specifically about, well, all parts of what it is to live in the South End, but also looking at gentrification. The second section is called The Struggle, and that's about the Black Lives Matter movement. And there's a lot to it. The third section is called The World, because I did have the opportunity to travel and to write about my travels. And I even got sent to Honduras at one point and got to, which was wild. Can you imagine checking your email, just minding your own business, and someone's like, hey, we need a journalist to go to Honduras. Wanna go? Yeah, passport ready. Of course I want to go to Honduras. Of course I want to go anywhere that anyone wants to pay for me to go to write for fun. Like, that's the dream. The next section is the people, because I did a lot of profiles and I got to interview incredible human beings, from Maru Mora Villapando, who is an incredible undocumented activist and organizer. Got to interview Masha from Pussy Riot, Moni Tepp, Howie Echohawk. Like, these were some really interesting people. And then the final section of the book is called The Body, because surprisingly, I ended up doing quite a few essays on what it's like living in my body specifically. So this is actually section 2, where you'll find work that's not been previously published, that there's some new pieces never before read. So I feel really vulnerable about it, but I'm also like, it is what it is. I said what I said. No apologies. So another thing I want you to kind of understand about this book Well, and actually, this is something we can kind of do together. I want to collectively just set some intentions around how I want this book to be used. I want anyone who's ever been drawn to writing, but kind of scared of it, or drawn to self-expression, wanting to use their voice, but somehow finding some blocks or barriers. I want you to read this book, not as a how-to manual, but as a you can manual. Because if I can like get over my own issues and figure it out, then I'm giving this book to you because I want you to also take the time to figure out what is it that you have to say, and then say it. The other intention I have is that I'd like this book to be read in communities by communities of people. Like, so if you have some friends that you're already in kind of a book club with, like take this as a book for book club. I want you to read each piece and get into a fist fight about it. No, I mean, don't hurt each other, but have a conversation. I think for me, like one of the most powerful things about writing in general is how words that I wrote down on paper can ripple out and be read years from now, decades, thousands of years from now, who knows when, and make an impact and make a difference, make somebody think about something in a different way than they ever have before. That's something powerful and beautiful and something I'm hoping that this book will do. Yes, please, Rainier Beach Urban Farmers, read this book together and tell me what you think about it. And it's okay if you don't love everything. I don't expect everybody to love everything that I've written because, well, again, back to this whole I have a lot of opinions thing. I have a lot of opinions. Yeah, and then I put them in a book. And of course, other people have other opinions that may or may not be right. But we can, you know, have that dialogue and have that conversation and connect and share. I'm trying to think. I felt like there was one more thing I wanted to say about this book. And then I'm going to read another excerpt. What I want to say is something that has stopped me in the past, or something that I had to really grapple with, was this idea of palatability, being a person that is palatable. Since I was a little kid, I have known that I was not always a person that was very palatable, that people didn't always respond well to what I would say or what I would think. And that made me feel a bit uncomfortable when it came to, like when people actually started reading my work, I was like, oh wow, it's really out there. They're really engaging with it. So I just wanna acknowledge, like to those of you who are at the beginning of your journey or your writing journeys, like it's okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to freak out from time to time, to have that moment where you're like, I wish I could just take it all back, but you can't, it's out there now. And the sun's gonna rise the next day and you're gonna be okay. And yeah, so, all right. So I have chosen another excerpt that I wanted to read before I bring Aisha out. This was originally published in the Seattle Globalist, December 26th, 2014, and it's called Black Lives Matter at a Crossroad. One of the reasons why I'm choosing to read this piece is because, unfortunately, it seems to be evergreen. Like, honestly, I could have written it this year and it would read pretty much the same, or I could have written it 40 years ago and it would read pretty much the same. And it's depressing and I'm angry about it, but I'm gonna read it anyway because it's important and because it's worth saying and I wanna say it out loud. After the grand jury acquitted Darren Wilson for murdering Michael Brown, I wanted to punch someone in the face. I've been pissed off since Trayvon Martin. No, since Amadou Diallo. No, wait, I've been mad since Rodney King. I don't know when grief and rage became a normal part of my experience of what it means to be Black in the US. It's just something I live with. But since the verdict, I found myself at the bottom of a deep and silent depression. It's not like this is the first time or the second time or the 100th time that someone of my skin color has been denied justice while their murderer walks away at least $500,000 richer. That verdict and many of the subsequent racist commentaries in the media confirmed for me something I already knew. I am not safe. Despite being theoretically protected by the Constitution and by our laws, if I were shot today by the very people we are supposed to entrust to uphold justice, it is likely that my death would be meaningless, just something that happened that no one would have to take accountability for. This is our America. This is what our collective consciousness has created and allowed to persist. I love protest rallies. As a community organizer, I was the go-to yeller, the one with the bullhorn in hand. Yet lately, it's been really difficult to even want to be near people, especially white people, even those who are allies. Dear white people, I don't want to talk about your feelings or hear your condolences. I certainly don't want to stand next to you at a protest and listen to you say, "Hands up, don't shoot." No one is shooting at you. These are the words I haven't said. This is what lies within my silence. I've withdrawn from friends and deliberately avoided having this conversation because I really do know in my heart of hearts that the white people in my life are doing the best they can. I also know it's not good enough. I know that whatever activism I have done up until this point has also failed. Collectively, these travesties of justice state clearly that whatever we've been doing is not working. It's almost 2015 and we are still not free. Not equal, not protected under the Constitution. We are still three-fifths human. One of the few things I've taken solace in have been the Facebook reports of protest overseas. People in Madrid and Tokyo standing in solidarity with the people of Ferguson. Those pictures have meant more to me than I can fully articulate. The protests have left me sad and feeling isolated. Yet somehow knowing someone an ocean away is moved to stand up for my human rights gives me hope. I was 16 the first time I went abroad. I traveled to Senegal with my mother. And though we were only gone for a month, being in a Black country after growing up in Madison, Wisconsin, was like taking a deep breath after being underwater. I didn't know it could be like that, that I could be anonymous, look around and see only Black people in every direction. It gave me an inkling of what it must be like to be white, to be the norm. To know that when someone follows you around in a store, it's probably to help you, or if they do think you're stealing, it's more about ageism or classism. When I'm in the States, my color is the first thing everyone sees. Depending on where I travel, color is still an issue, but there is no racism quite like the racism I experience here at home, perhaps because it is my home. So the question is still, where do we go from here? I can't pick a new country out of a hat and start a new life in it, nor should I have to. Moreover, who's to say I would fare any better anywhere else? What I've come to realize is that these verdicts not only compromise the civil rights of Black Americans, but have also put the US in violation of the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights. By my count, we are failing in Article 3, quote, everyone has the right to life, liberty, and the security of person. Article 6, everyone has the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law. And Article 7, all are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. All are entitled to equal protection against any discrimination in violation of this declaration and against any incitement to such discrimination. While protest pictures are nice, My request is that the international community step in to support us to do what we seem to not be able to do for ourselves. We are at a crossroads. Help us to create a climate of human dignity and accountability. During a conversation with a friend, I was reminded of how all of humanity has benefited from the existence of Black Americans. That even through our most dire trials, through the civil rights movement, abolition, and fighting to end slavery, who we are and our struggle for liberation and equality has elevated not only our own consciousness, but the consciousness of our nation, and in fact, the consciousness of our world. He reminded me that these very injustices occurring today might be the catalyst for our evolution as Americans. As I meditated upon his thoughts, what occurred to me is that if all of humanity is going to benefit from her suffering, then all of humanity is also responsible for helping ensure that this never happens again. Never again. That's what we said about the Holocaust. That's what we said about Hiroshima and Nagasaki. In order for those words to apply now, it is not enough for us to act as US citizens. In this age of globalization, we must act collectively as human beings, as global citizens, to change the course of our future so that our great grandchildren aren't still dealing with this bullshit. All right. Yes, a little light piece there. I am going to bring on Aisha Al-Amin. Aisha is currently the Donor Relations Manager for Powerful Voices. She also works with the alumni of Young Women Empowered and is indeed an alumna of, of Young Women Empowered. She is also an incredible writer and my dear friend.
I love that intro. Thanks, Reagan. thanks for having me after that really light reading. You know, I also just want to verify the date for everyone that Reagan published that December 26th of 2014, and that it's now 2021. And when we were talking about this, I was like, Reagan, if you told me you wrote this yesterday, it would make so much sense to me. So,
I mean, just change the names, right? Let's add Breonna Taylor in there. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a Aubrey, Tony McDade.
Yes. Yeah. You know. And also just when you're reading it, Reagan, I'm just thinking about some of the language that you even just say in this. I think a lot of folks are starting to use now. And one of my favorite things to notice in the world is if Reagan Jackson was saying it 5 years ago, then we're starting to make sense of it now. That's how the world works. Reagan said it 5 years ago, so now we'll finally start to realize, you know, that it's very true.
Anybody who's ever argued with me, remember this moment.
Remember it.
Because 5 years from now, when you like, you know, see how long you were wrong.
Listen, and that's all. No. But I'm very excited to be here with you, Reagan, and to talk about this amazing book. And I have my coffee and it's so beautiful and aww, I love it so much. When I was thinking about this, I wrote down, I literally have in front of me, I think perhaps 25 questions.
Oh, okay.
So many came up. But I've gone through and highlighted the ones that I think will be the most interesting. And the one I kind of wanted to start with is, what's in the name? How did you decide on the name? Why Still Here?
Well, that's a good question. Part of it is because I am such a weird, like I said, my relationship with journalism is such a weird thing. And that I kind of, it was kind of a joke in and of itself of like, yep, I'm still here, still writing. Like, you know, it's still happening. And also in reference as well to the permanence of Black women and Black feminist women and our contributions, like we are still here. Mm-hmm. And I feel like, yeah, I wanted this to be something that lasts.
Yeah.
Whether or not, you know, I choose to continue in journalism or not. Like, mm-hmm.
I mean, absolutely. I mean, I know that your mother is here tonight, and we can talk about a lasting Black feminist right there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Great. Another, these two questions are kind of just based off of the cover of the book, but on the back we have, a quote from Virgie talking about how this book should be basically required reading for all journalists. And I'm wondering for you, do you have any other books or other forms of media that come to mind that you think all journalists should be required to either read or watch?
Ooh, that's a great question. First, I love the idea of being required reading. Yes, absolutely, require me.
I know you do.
I feel like I had a really great answer to this question. Where did it go? Well, for one thing, I think it should be required if you're planning on being a journalist or a writer in general, you have to read, period. So let's just say that reading itself is required. But I think for me, Audre Lorde, Sister Outsider, especially like talking about the uses of anger. I think that should be required reading. I know, like, it's funny, like, I feel like I should be recommending like journalism books, but that's not how I feel about it. I think that the things that you should be reading are anything, any book that cultivates empathy or understanding other human beings. So that could be completely a different genre. It could be poetry, it could be memoir, but whatever it is that when you read it makes you feel like you are more deeply connected to someone else's experience, that's what you should be reading.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I'm already going off script of all my questions now, but you talked about, you know, at the beginning of the hour, your dad, you know, giving you some sage wisdom for your your journalism journey. And about that situation that came up with that woman who was Somali, who had that horrific experience, and having to decide to honor your empathy and her experience. I guess I'm just kind of wondering, like, as a journalism, how do you keep that empathy up in deadlines and just with so many things going on? We kind of have like this culture of just, I think, especially the little work I've done in journalism, of meeting deadlines and getting stuff going and moving. How do you center like your humanity and the humanity of others?
You know, that's something that I feel like is a continuous struggle. And part of it is making sure that you are transparent about that's what you're prioritizing. So that whoever you're working with has that understanding of you as a writer. Because I always feel like when people understand how you think or the ways in which the decisions you've made around your ethics, that they can be less surprised, when you are consistently acting on those values. And deadlines are a real thing. Like, yeah, you know, when you decide to write, especially if it were print media, but even with digital stuff, like you still have time and space is an issue. So it's always good, I think, to have backup ideas. Like, don't just put all your eggs in one story basket.
Yeah, absolutely. You gotta diversify.
But also, I was thinking about it's been challenging because I also feel like these are things that you have to take case by case. Like, I made that decision not to tell her story, but then there was another article I did that's in this book as well around the POC yoga story. Which I made the decision to write that story. And I felt like, well, granted, at the time, the yoga instructors were getting death threats. And so they really were like, I don't want to talk about it. Like, I don't want to talk to press. I can't be interviewed. Da, da. But I decided I felt like the story was needed to be told. And I did my best to like honor that. But I know that like, it was such a traumatizing experience that there are like one of the teachers would prefer if we like just never told the story or just took it down, but mm-hmm. I actually felt like that would be doing our community a disservice. Because this is a really serious issue. And for those of you who aren't familiar, I feel like I'm talking to you like you've read the story and you may not have. But basically, a few blocks from me, not too far from my house in Rainier Beach, there's a yoga studio run by my friend and my neighbor. We weren't friends or neighbors before before this, actually. That's kind of, this is how we met. This is our meet cute. she's a white lady who made the decision to invite POC yoga to use her studio where they could just have, you know, have specifically POC classes. And then she put it on our website and she sent an email to her clientele, just letting them know that this was an offering that was going to happen at the studio. And one of the people on our client list sent it to a conservative shock jock, Dory Monson, who then turned it into this national news story of the oppression of white people because they couldn't go to this one yoga class in this very small studio for this 1 hour of the one day. Like, they made it sound like she was like, yoga is only for people of color forever. And like, it was like literally like one class like once a month or something, you know. It was pretty mm-hmm. ridiculous. But yeah, they turned it into this huge thing. And I felt like we need to talk about it.
Absolutely. And because, you know, in Seattle there's only one yoga studio, so that makes sense, all the upset, because there's only one.
There's only one tiny yoga studio in Rainier Beach
in the whole place. Well, I mean you're talking a bit about how folks in the community have responded when they've had backlash, whether it be like from your articles or just the situation in general. How have you responded to getting such negative feedback? I can't remember which article it was, but I do remember when we worked together one time, like you coming in and there was just like message after message after message about some article you've written. And I was like, whew, could not be me. Glad it's not. So how do you deal with that?
I mean, it kind of depends. Like, some of it I find like incredibly entertaining. And I'm like, you know, it's like that Michael Jackson meme where I'm eating the popcorn, like, like just like reading these people, you know, it's cool. Never in a million years did I anticipate that that my writing would be so inflammatory or so like, you know, conversation provoking. And it's good. That makes me feel really great. And every once in a while, depending on how close I am to the subject matter, sometimes I feel deeply uncomfortable. Brad and Becky, that article comes to mind.
Yeah.
I did the Brad and Becky are coming, what should have been Brad and Becky are coming for Rainier Beach, because that's the title I wrote. But the title as published was Brad and Becky are coming to Rainier Beach. And I was prepositions matter. But I wrote about like what it's like to live in a neighborhood that's gentrifying. Mm-hmm. And because I also included like pictures of my lawn signs, which were, you know, also a precursor to the article, people were like driving by my house and taking pictures of my house.
Mm-hmm.
That felt super invasive. So I actually ended up taking the lawn signs down, not because I wanted to take them down, but just because it's one thing to be trolled in a comment section and it's another thing to be trolled in your home.
Mm-hmm.
So I've definitely, that's something I think, especially as a new writer, you have to begin to prepare yourself for how vulnerable you're willing to be.
Mm-hmm.
and act accordingly, because if you share something, like, it's out there, it's really mm-hmm. out there. This is what I try to tell youth about naked selfies. Like, if you can't, they're somewhere in the cloud. If you put it out there, it's gonna be out there forever.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, the past year, Reagan, you've totally switched into a tech genius. as aided by our mutual friend Mira, so I know that you know what's going on. And I just checked the date, and I think that article you just mentioned is actually the one that I'm remembering when I was in AmeriCorps working with you at YWE, of there just being a lot of comments and just a lot of passion on all sides from that. Another question I had just when going through this, because I've also been a friend of yours for years, and I also know that you write like it's going out of style. Like it can disappear at any moment. That's how quick you write. So I know that though there, I mean, for me, when I'm looking at this book, I'm like, whoa, there is such a wealth of articles here spanning so many different topics. But I also know that your actual work is so much bigger than the articles that are here. So how did you, when you were initially deciding to do this book, how did you decide on the articles that would be in it?
Ooh, that's hard. It was hard. Cause I do have a whole bunch of work. And so at a certain point I needed outside support, cause like the book was really, really long. So actually that was something that my editor, Quentin Baker, helped me with, was going through and telling me like which articles did the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, because like I was like, I really love this article and I love this article, and he's like, yeah, but they both do the same thing, so pick one. And that was incredibly helpful. Thank you, Quentin, you're amazing. I'd also like to take this moment to do a little Reagan Jackson commercial, and to remind you that this is not my first book. Mm-mm. This was my first book. Yes. God, Hair, Love, and America. These are my three collections of poetry, which you can read at the Seattle Public Library, or you can buy at any independent bookseller or Amazon. I know you hate Amazon. It's okay. You can buy them somewhere else. And then, yeah, these are my two children's books, Coco the Swish. And then in addition to that, the South Seattle Emerald put out several different anthologies. Got Flight of the Assemblies,
yes.
Emerald Reflections, I'm in here as well. And most recently, Black Imagination, also in there. So yes, yes, I am prolific. I write a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And it is kind of that, what is it, that Alexander Hamilton?
Yes.
You know, I'm not gonna waste my shot here. Like,
yeah,
I have a lot in me.
Yeah.
To say, and a lot of different ways I'd like to say it, and so I'm just gonna keep going until I run out.
Which I feel like is never gonna happen. Always new stories with you.
That's the hope.
My last question is just because when I'm going through these articles, I'm nosy and I just like to know things. I want to know if you have a favorite article that's in here.
Oh.
No, it's choosing between children, but I
know,
like,
I'm like, do I?
No, like conflict, so I want to know.
Oh, I mean, but I like different articles for different reasons. So that's why I'm like, it's kind of like asking me to pick what's my favorite country. I don't know. the one with the best speech in the moment. but yeah, I would say, random pick, but I stand by my review of Get Out.
I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's one where I was like, I feel like I really got it right. I guess that kind of goes into like what my writing process is like, or what it's like for me as I'm like working on stuff. Sometimes the words just come, like they flow through me. Sometimes it's hard and I have to like fight for every word. And sometimes it's like I'm reaching for something and I'm not quite there, but I can edit it to a place where then I'm like, oh, there, I'm there.
Absolutely.
So I guess, yeah, any article when I get to the end and I'm like, oh, I did that. Okay.
Yeah. That's that whenever that point happens is the favorite article. Yeah, absolutely. Well, Reagan, I have loved talking with you just about the book. I mean, I literally, y'all, I am not joking. I have in front of me 25 plus questions. And I act like I don't talk to Reagan every other day. I talk to her so much and I still always have so many questions because she's a prolific writer and person. And I feel very lucky that I got to have this time with you to talk about this amazing new book.
Oh, thank you so much, Aisha.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I see in the chat, Miss Patricia is asking if I'll read a little bit of that. I will. Yes, I will. I'm going to read a little bit of that, and then I'm going to read another article. And then we're going to talk to Danny Terrell. But yeah, so this is called The Scariest Thing About Get Out is Black Trauma, and it was published originally in the South Seattle Emerald March 4th, 2017. I hate horror movies. They linger. Long after the screen goes black, I am reliving every cringeworthy moment. So when I saw the previews for Get Out, I was like, wait, is this a horror movie or is this racism? Is this a horror movie about racism? Oh, hell no, I definitely don't want to see that. Eventually, I succumbed to curiosity and peer pressure. True to the genre, Get Out is a movie that lingers, but in a very different way than most. It's the subtle violence that gets under your skin. Writer and director Jordan Peele does a masterful job of creating scene after scene filled with microaggressions, white privilege run amok, and downright awkward racist interactions. The movie begins with Rose, Allison Williams, and Chris, Daniel Kaluuya, making googly eyes at one another, establishing themselves as a couple in love. All the Black women sitting in my row, myself included, gave a collective eye roll. Becky meets a brother. Okay. That's only the plot of like 900 other movies. Hashtag save the last dance. Hashtag guess who's coming to dinner. Hashtag Othello. And Rose is the quintessential Becky, perky and progressive, the daughter of parents who, quote, would have voted for Obama a third time if they could. They discuss their plans for Chris to meet Rose's family. Chris asks if they know he's Black. Rose says no, because she is entirely too post-racial to have really noticed that he is Black, let alone mention that to her equally post-racial family. She also lets it slip that he is the first Black man she's ever dated. Yeah, right. Which so perfectly frames the paradox of white people wanting to be both colorblind and congratulated on their sophisticated race relations at the same time. Chris calls his friend Rod, played by a comedian Little Rel Howery, who tells him pretty much everything everyone in the audience is thinking. Don't go. This is a bad idea. Something isn't right. But of course, Chris goes anyway, because white people inviting you to white spaces with other white people that may or may not be cool is actually an everyday kind of thing. What follows is a montage of the way too true shit that happens when you are Black in white spaces, beginning with a slightly new twist on an old classic, the DWB, Driving While Black. While on the way to the countryside, they hit a deer. It's jarring. They are both stunned. When the police officers arrive, though Rose was the one actually driving, he asked to see Chris's driver's license. One of them is stunned by this, one of them is not. You can guess who. So Rose pulls out her white feminist crusader cape, and after a short and snarky assertion of her white privilege, they are back in the car and on their way. Here you see the first crack in the lovey-dovey, we are a couple facade. It's that moment where two people realize that they were raised differently and have completely different understandings of what just happened and why. The moment when Chris remembers that Rose's whiteness can be dangerous, hashtag Emmett Till, and Rose realizes for 0.5 seconds that the post-racial bubble that she likes to live in might not have enough room for two. Throughout the movie, we watch Chris rationalize his relationships again and again, bestowing unsolicited silent forgiveness for all the bullshit simply being with Rose requires of him, and all the lies and mental gymnastics dictates to keep believing it's not that bad, except it is that bad. And I'll let you read the rest. It goes on. And now I'm going to read The Necessity of Black Joy, originally published in Seattle Globalist, July 18th, 2017. The second annual Where Does Black Joy Live? A Day of Dance and Celebration was held last Sunday afternoon at Othello Park. Drawn by the beat A gorgeous sunny day and the promise of community, I found my way to a small concrete stage at the center of the grass. There, Danny Terrell, the creator of the event, and his friend Alexander Jackson greeted me with smiles and hugs. "I don't do titles," said Terrell. "I'm trying to take myself out of titling myself as a dancer. I'm a creator, and I think we all are, and we put labels on what it is we create, which means we are stuck in this box. So I'm trying to get out of my own box and say, I create stuff, and it's all movement-based, but I just create stuff." Terrell's latest creation has been a series of house music pop-up dance workshops. I grew up with house music. In Detroit, being queer and Black and going to clubs, it was all about house music, explained Terrell. And it was just the style of music that speaks to something deeper inside of myself. It's really where I find my spiritual place. For this gathering, Terrell took his love of house and love for Black community and used it to create a space for Black joy. The Facebook invitation framed the event beautifully, acknowledging the challenges we've all experienced and posing a vital question. Yes, there's pain, anger, fear, and hurt. Yes, people from the African diaspora are still getting killed. Trans Black women are all still getting killed. But can we find a moment of Black joy? The first gathering took place last summer. About 30 people attended. For Terrell, it was part birthday party and part love offering for community activists. "Black people are tired," he said. "We're exhausted. And it was really last year, the height of just protest and people talking about Black bodies being killed. And I was just like, I need some joy." This year's celebration coincided with the memorial of dance legend Cabbie Mitchell III, who is the first Black dancer at the Pacific Northwest Ballet. Mitchell passed away in May at the age of 60 due to coronary artery disease. Both Terrell and Jackson danced at his memorial earlier in the day before arriving at the park to continue the celebration. The party is still going and will still be going, because you can't celebrate his life in a day, because he has done so much for the city and this universe, said Jackson, who is an instructor with the Northwest Tap Connection and was also mentored by Mitchell. "We can't just celebrate him in a day." Jackson didn't attend the event last year, but was happy to dance this year. "Baby, to be honest, I think we're all a lot more comfortable in our Blackness this year," said Jackson. "It took Trump being president. Well, first it took Barack Obama being president to give us the confidence that we knew we already had to know at the end of the day, honey, we are beautiful and we can do anything we put our minds to. And so look at us, we are here, honey, and there is something so beautiful about that." As the sun sunk lower in the sky, more people arrived, some bearing chips and even a couple of pizzas to share. "Y'all need to introduce yourselves to one another," Terrell intoned frequently. "This is not going to be a thing where people come and nobody speaks." An hour into the event, the first white person arrived. I wasn't surprised. I've lived in Seattle long enough to expect that sort of entitlement, but I did find myself feeling annoyed. Terrell greeted her with the same warmth he greeted everyone else. "If white people would have come, they need to bring a Black friend or something to offer," said Terrell, "but I'm not going to tell them no." Kate Bennett did not bring a Black friend, but she did bring a massage table. "I'm a healthcare worker. I'm a licensed reflexologist. I'm on the board of the Washington Reflexology Association," said Bennett. In the wake of the Black Lives Matter movement, Bennett has found herself drawn to Black communities. In a recent conversation with two Black women, Bennett had a personal revelation. They said healthcare for Black women is the worst of any demographic. Through Planned Parenthood, they were telling me the statistics and all that, and I thought, I'm in healthcare and I can do something about that, she said. That's why I'm here. Though her intentions were admirable and I wanted to support her burgeoning allyships, I couldn't help but feeling robbed. Suddenly this pop-up dance party was no longer about my joy, but about her education. Over the years, my life has been inundated with well-meaning white people who have asked me to share my experiences about what it is to be Black. Well-meaning is generous. If I were to be honest, they are white people with privileged curiosity, seeking to have a deeper understanding of race without wanting to admit complicity with systems of oppression or acknowledging the depth of trauma they asked me to relive in order to educate them. They prioritize their education, their own education, over my well-being without a second thought. This has been a reoccurring phenomenon throughout my life, and I am exhausted. Living in this toxic environment, where even social media feels like a landmine of exploding trauma, from the latest police shootings and hashtags to the unexpected craziness of former childhood friends turned racist assholes in post-Trump America. I would say I have PTSD, but that denotes that trauma has ended, when truly our struggles are unending. So the idea of taking a few hours to gather together with other Black people, not to discuss race, not to bitch about white people, but to simply disengage and dance and laugh and remember our own humanity, is truly powerful. The very best way white people can show their allyship is by not interrupting that time, by not centering their needs to feel included or their desires to help. There will be a time for us to come together as a human collective, to educate one another, to argue, to navigate healing and justice, and to do the difficult work of fixing what is broken between us. But there must also be a time for Black people to come together in the privacy of our own communities, to laugh and cry, to dance and love and enjoy one another. We're not worrying about who's looking. We're not worrying about who's judging. We're just like, baby, this is us. And we're going to do and be ourselves and just let us be us, for us, by us, said Jackson. We are going to live in our Black boy, Black girl joy, honey, and love it and just embrace it. And here with me this evening is the incomparable Danny Terrell. Welcome, Danny.
Hello.
How are you doing tonight?
I am good. I just got through teaching class, so that's why everything looks the way that it does. You know, I generally try to, you know, like glam it up a little bit, but today I was like, I'm teaching class and I'm still supporting Reagan. So this is what you got today.
Aw, thanks for coming. What class are you teaching?
I'm teaching my preteens, well, they're teens now, but the younger set of teens, house dance. So interesting that we're talking about this right now.
I love it. Well, you know, just, I wanted to include you in this because I did write this article about you, and I wanted to just have my, you know, readers have the opportunity to kind of hear an update of like where you are now since that event. And I'm wondering, like, have you hosted any subsequent Black Joy events?
I guess yes. I did this little show that everyone talks about a lot, called Black Boys. And I guess that was just a huge 2-year process of Black Joy, 3-year process of Black Joy. So that was probably one of the last shows that a lot of people seen since we moved into COVID and isolation. So I would say that was definitely one of them.
Yeah. Do you want to share a bit more about like the inspiration behind that show? And I was lucky enough to get to see it in person.
Yes. That show had to deal with a few things, definitely inspiration was Khalif Browder, was a young 22 around the time that he died by suicide. And he was locked away in Rikers Island for many years when he was a teenager for a crime he did not commit. And then they released him, like the mental health wasn't there, and the hell that he went through being inside of Rikers Island just took its toll on him. So that story inspired me because, again, when you talk about male identity, masculine identity, we don't talk about mental and emotional health. Men are seen as criminals. Black men are seen as criminals. End of discussion. And then when we're just through with you in the system, we just let you go and we're, you know, you do whatever. And this person wound up killing himself, dying by suicide. And then the other inspiration was my nephew, Anthony Hooks, Miles Anthony Hooks. He died when he was 13 of complications from a degenerative disease that he had. And that his dad, which is my brother, my older brother, like, we don't talk about what Black men go through and how they take care of their families. We're always talking about the opposite of that. So it was really inspired by like seeing my brother, who I completely admire. Like, I adore my brother so much. Moved through the process of losing a child, and my nephew was a twin, so his twin brother is still alive. But to see how my brother, he could have ran, he could have walked away, he could have did those things that we think people, or we put on Black folks, especially Black male identified folks. My brother was at every hospital visit, in the bed with my nephew, like soothing his nephew. So to see this life being taken away, and to see this man like crumble, that was part of it. And then my dad, who was on drugs for many years, and through his addiction and through his recovery, like how he just continued to love his children and be there for his children. So it was a lot of different inspirations. My queerness, of course, my non-binariness, the cast and the other creatives were part of that inspiration also.
That's beautiful. So going back into the article, you talk about the legacy of Cabby Mitchell. And it made me wonder, especially in light of, you know, what you just shared, like, what is the correlation between grief and joy, and how can both coexist, and how does one impact the other?
That is what I continue to explore. I think for myself, I've been reading, I read a lot about like the use of ciphers, the use of circles, and how ancient they are, and how, especially within African cultures, how those ciphers and circles were like meant for grief, for joy, for celebration, for death. Like, it was meant for so many things. So anytime that I'm involved in a cipher situation, even if I'm grieving, there's an amount of joy. So even in creating like dance for me at this point in time, there has to be some type of circular community element involved. Again, because even at our height of grief, something about movement and dance and us being able to see and witness each other brings about joy. So even thinking about like Cabby, who my first encounter with Cabby was just like, you ain't right. Like, pretty much is what Cabby said to me. And I was just like, this person. And that's my first time moving into Seattle. But through that, Cabby like stayed on me and stayed on top of me and 100% supported everything that I've done. So, you know, I think about the circles and the ciphers and the ancestors in grief. And through the grief of losing Cabby, we are still able to celebrate him and bring joy, because his life was joyful, period. The Cabby that I knew was very joyful. So that's how it mixes up and intertwines for me.
Well, final question. How do you feel like your relationship with joy has evolved?
My joy at this point in time, it really does not involve a lot of non-Black people. And I know that may be harsh for some folks, but with everything that we have been going through inside of this world, it is something around me being around folks that look like me, that may have the same experience for me, that energizes me so much. And I realize, I realize that being around other folks, the thing that you said in your article is just like, sometimes people don't understand they can take the energy and they can drain and move the energy out of the space. And so my joy at this point in time really involves me still being in community with predominantly Black folks. That doesn't mean I'm not in community with other people, but I'm intentional about the spaces that I'm in with Black folks. And also trying to make sure that I love Black folks, I love on Black folks, and that is how my joy is evolving. you know, trying not so much to tear Black people down, but to love on Black folks even more and more and more so.
That's beautiful. Oh, well, thank you for taking the time to come and celebrate with us today.
Of course. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, and this is part of my journey has been getting to have these kinds of conversations. And a big part of this book is having these conversations with people in community and not just getting to say what I want to say, which of course I love to do, but also getting to extend that platform so that other people in the community can share what is needed. So thanks for sharing.
Yay, awesome. You're welcome. Thank you so much for having me. Yay.
Absolutely.
Great.
All right. Well, I think we are coming into our final Q&A, so I'm going to invite Michael Main out. So for those of you who have not had the pleasure, Michael B. Main is a photographer, videographer, media mogul, and also my publisher. He just launched Minerva Labs. And the purpose of Minerva Labs is to elevate the writing of folks of color, and particularly Black folks. And so I'm really happy to be your first client. Thanks for being here.
Yeah, of course. Thank you for having me. And I'm excited that you are the first collaborator in this endeavor. So thank you. Thank you for saying yes. Thanks for being here.
Yeah. Well, so now is the time to audience where if you have questions, you can kind of throw those in the chat. And then, and Michael, if you have any questions, we'll start with you.
Ooh, start with me. Okay, I definitely have questions. For anybody who's in the audience or attending, feel free to leave your questions and I will do my best to make sure we get to those. Tell us about, ooh, okay, cool. All right, I will acquiesce and give you a question first, but I do really like this question that I'm hoping I'm pronouncing his name correctly, Sonora just put in the chat, but I will go ahead and ask you a question. And this is really, a lot of this is in response to both you and Danny Terrell. So Danny Terrell, first of all, props for helping shift some of my thinking because you do a very good job, I think, of elevating the joy, like Black joy, and specifically talking about that. And that's one of the things that I really appreciate about Reagan, your article about that. And so the first question I have is there any part of journalism or any particular articles or anything in your history with this project and your writing and you as a person that you found particularly fun?
Ooh, well, questions, actually. I like writing questions. I like thinking through, like, when I'm about to interview someone or when I'm approaching like an event or something that I'm gonna cover, like what are the questions that will bring the story alive? Or what are the questions that are needed? Like that's actually the thing I think I also get most irritated by is like when I'm watching the news and people are asking dumb questions, I'm like, oh yeah, like I get that, why, I understand why you're asking that question, but you could also have asked a completely different question that would have like gotten underneath, you know, the superficial stuff and gotten to that deeper level.
Why, thank you, Reagan Jackson. All right, I appreciate you answering that. And the first question from the attendees that I want to ask is, can you tell us how this collaboration came to be?
Oh, I mean, I feel like that's a question for both of us, so you can say your part. but my answer would be, I'm trying to remember when we first met, Michael, but I feel like even before we met, I knew you because you were on the board of Real Girls. And I did an article about that and about particularly about the allyship of having a man on the board of Real Girls. And so from then on, like, I feel like I've just kind of watched the way you have showed up in community and seen that that you fill the right spaces, I should say. Like, you are both someone I see as an ally and an advocate, particularly for girls of color, and a person that I've seen be a safe person for them to share with and talk to. And that to me is like, I always feel like I let the youth vouch for people for me, like who should be in my life or who shouldn't be in my life is often based on, you know, they're very attuned bullshit detectors. But what came up for me is we had a conversation like a long time ago, and you were talking about the publishing industry. And I was talking about one of the reasons why I've chosen to be self-published is because I have a very specific vision for what I want to do. And I haven't yet come across a publisher who shares that vision or understands it. And so you were talking about your vision for creating more accessibility and publishing and uplifting the voices that aren't always heard. And I thought, yeah, I talk a lot, but I'm not always heard. And I would love the opportunity to really make use of that kind of a platform. And I felt like you're somebody that I could trust to work with.
Well, thank you, Reagan Jackson. I hope that still rings true today.
It does. I say as I hold my beautiful new book.
I'll briefly talk a little bit about that. For me, this has been a dream for several years, and I find people very interesting. Like, I find humans very interesting, and growing up, I remember, especially when it comes to media, I would always hear, see, and experience stories that felt like our voices, and by our, I mean Black people specifically, our voices were left out of the writing table. Like, I would often see myself or people that look like me or sound like me or something in media, but whenever I would dive into how that was produced, I never saw Black faces almost ever. And so, and then as I got older, I kept hearing, like, I would see things and not experience things. And I was like, why is it so difficult to find a book about this thing or from this perspective or from with these experiences? Because they're fascinating and they're important. You know, just hearing you again read some of the words that you've read tonight, it saddens me to know that these are words that oftentimes, not to say that they wouldn't be heard at all, but to hear that other publishers are denying the opportunity for people like you to share your stories to a broader audience because of things like, oh, well, we can't take a risk on you, like, you're unproven. And when I hear people say things like, oh, this person is unproven, especially when it comes to people like Reagan Jackson, I go, how is this person unproven? Not, first of all, not only have you already written several books, but the way you show up in community is it's amazing. It's a beautiful thing. Like, you've done so much around bringing community together, leading things, sharing, like, just, I've watched people grow, especially through Young Women Empowered. Like, I've watched people grow over a period of 5, 6, 7 years, come from a place where they were oftentimes shut down or lacked confidence, to being people like Aisha, who right now gave one of the most fun interviews that I've ever heard, and like, in deep and meaningful questions, and questions that weren't toxic and were uplifting and insightful, and show that, hey, I read your work. I know you as a person and I care about you as a person. And so, like, how does this come about? It comes about through conversations and involving people as collaborators and partners in this process, and sitting down with people like you, Reagan, and saying, like, what do you want? How do you want this thing to happen? Like, this is your work. You have invested in this. This is not a project that is about making money off of somebody else's labor. It's about ensuring that the work and the energy that you have put into this and the love that you've put into this is crafted with people who care about you and care about this work, so that we can create something that we can all be proud of, and then invite people in to witness and bear witness to what you have to say and share. And it's not just an investment in Reagan, it's an investment in the entire community, because I feel we all grow from being able to bear witness to this. So for me, that's how that came about. I love Reagan Jackson. I love you, the human. I'll say it to your face. And like, there's no reason that somebody shouldn't, quote unquote, take a chance. Like, no. The whole idea behind publishing for me is to remove the risk from somebody from somebody being able to share their work so they can focus on the things that they like, focus on the things that you want to do and that you are good at, and then help bring together other resources to get your work out there. Okay, all right, I'm done. That should be my last answer for anything. And
thank you, Michael.
Yeah, of course. Okay, I have other questions, but I'm gonna go to the chat. Let's see what we have here. Michael, do you have a favorite piece? No, I do not, but I'll give a more detailed answer later on. Let's see. All right, here is a question. Can you share if and how the process of writing can transform your self-understanding and lead to your personal growth?
Ooh, it's like asking me how magic works. I don't know, but it's magic and it works. I don't know. For me, writing, that I was a writer is one of the first things I ever knew about myself. And it's been kind of the catalyst for a whole bunch of different decisions I've made about my life. Like, one of the reasons I wanted to travel is so that I would have something interesting to write about. But it's also through the process of journaling, through the process of just writing over the course of time, I feel like it's been a bit of a time capsule, or like a way that I could look back and see who I was or how I thought at certain different points in my life. And that is helpful, I think, in terms of growth. The way that we are as humans is, if you don't change and grow, you die. So like, I feel like everybody is changing and growing all of the time, but writing gives you the tools to quantify that, or to kind of mark that out and be like, okay, this is what has shifted in me. You know, it's kind of like Harry Potter's pensive. You can take the thoughts out of your head and put it on paper and just get better perspective on it.
Reagan Jackson, that's beautiful. All right, let's see here. You quote at the very beginning of the book in the foreword, you say, if I define, you quote Audre Lorde, if I define myself for myself, if I didn't define myself for myself, how do you define yourself?
Well, as a writer. that's a great question. How do I define myself? I'm a person with a lot of different parts. There's a lot of different moving parts to how I think and how I feel and the ways in which I move in the world. First and foremost, I'm a human being. I am. And it feels like such a simple thing to say, but as a Black person, as a Black American especially, I feel like I have to state that obvious thing, because so much of my experience has been kind of a negation of that, has been other people defining and determining what my skin color, or, you know, their perceptions of my gender or my body or my sexual orientation. Like, it's so much of other people getting to say who I'm supposed to be. I define myself as a beautiful, evolving human being with a lot of flaws and a lot of talent and gifts and joy and grief and love and family and compassion and strength and a willingness to be vulnerable.
Speaking of, you just used the term evolve. How would some of these pieces were written 2012, 2013, 2014, and you're still writing. How would you say that you have evolved from the beginning of, I don't want to say the beginning of Reagan Jackson, but let's say the first article that appears in this book. How have you your writing, your journalism, how have you evolved over the years?
I think over time, my voice is clearer. I find I'm faster at writing than ever before because the pathway is practiced. You know, it's like whenever you're building a new skill or a new habit, your brain has to create new, what is it, those synapses or, you know, things that fire, like neural pathways. And I feel like through the process of practice, that I'm sharper, I'm clearer, clearer in what I want to say and how I want to say it, and less judgmental of my own instincts. I feel like that was something I kept having to wrestle with earlier on in my career, is feeling like that, like I mentioned before, the imposter syndrome, or just feeling like I'm doing it differently, so I'm doing it wrong. Or feeling like some of my earlier work, I over-researched or over-prepared because I wanted to make everything bulletproof. Like, I don't want anybody to be able to poke any holes in this logic. Like, I want it to be what it is. And I feel like now I'm more comfortable with the fact that not everyone is going to agree with me. That's fine. Like, I don't need that.
Thank you. We have about 3 minutes left, and I'll very quickly respond to the question about what is my favorite piece from Reagan Jackson. And the answer is I don't have a favorite piece, individual piece. I think as a collection, one of the things that you do in your writing is you make me want to read more. And understand more around about the community, and you've increased my level of awareness around what's happening in the world that I occupy and the people in it, and some of the folks who are here today I never heard of until I read your writing, and I was like, wow, these people are amazing. So for me, there's not one individual piece, but collectively I think you are very successful, at least in my life, of making me a much more informed and caring individual. And so my favorite piece is all of them. Even if I don't agree, it provides perspective, which is going to lead me to my last question, 1.5 anyway, is you often talk about, and you write it in the very beginning of your book as well, in that journalism often is taught to be quote unquote unbiased and everything, but in your writing, you have a very clear perspective, at least in my opinion, a very clear perspective. What is your relationship with journalism, bias, and perspective?
Yeah, I think being unbiased is a myth perpetrated by white supremacist culture. That is the bias. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I would prefer to be honest and be like, this is actually, I'm coming from the perspective of a fourth generation Black feminist. It's who I am. It's how I think. It's how I write. And I'm not going to apologize for it or hide it. And I think that anyone reading my work will benefit from me being transparent about those things. And I offered up an invitation to other journalists to do the same. Something I did as kind of like an experiential activity, because I played this game with a group of visiting journalists where they were visiting a foreign culture for the first time. And so like there was one group that was playing one part of the culture and another group that was playing the other part, and they each had different information. And then at the end of it, I had them kind of write different perspectives. And what we did was we read the perspectives of the people visiting the culture for the first time and the other culture for the first time, and then people completely outside of it. And what we discovered is that the people who really understood what the culture was about wrote a better and more accurate article than the people who were quote unquote unbiased. So I really think it's a myth that unbiased is better somehow.
I know you have a bunch of opinions. That is one I agree with. okay, I know it's 7:31. I want to be respectful of time. Last question for you, Reagan Jackson.
Okay.
As a journalist, you're often asking a bunch of questions to other people. Are there any questions that you wish people would ask you? Or are there any questions that you particularly have wanted to answer that you haven't already done so in your writing?
I want to say yes, but they're all like usually situationally. Mm-hmm. Things like, do you want some water? Yes, I want some water. Or also like, sometimes I'd like to be asked why? Why this one? Why this story? Why is it important?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. And thank you everyone for coming. I'm like, next steps, start that book group. Like, you know, buy that copy, start the book group, tell me how it's going. I'm interested in hearing more. And again, thank you for coming.
Thank you so much. That was just a beautiful evening. So thank you so much for bringing everybody together, and congratulations on the publication. It's super exciting. I can't wait to read it. Thanks again to Aisha, Danny, Michael, and of course, Reagan for being here. As I mentioned at the beginning of the program, we would love to get your feedback on the event. So we are posting a link in the survey that will be in the chat, and you'll just need to copy and paste that into your browser window to fill that out when we're done tonight. And thanks so much. And we're so grateful to tonight's program sponsors, Minerva Lab Publishing, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times. And of course, we're grateful to all of you for joining us tonight. Thank you so much for being here. And we'll see you next time. Good night, Reagan. Congratulations.
Good night. Thank you, everyone.